teacher is Dr. Fred Nour. He's a neurologist and trained at Baylor, who is board certified in both neurology and neurophysiology. He's a member of the Royal College of Surgeons of England, and he teaches a neurology part-time at the University of California Irvine. He's also written a book, True Love, How to Use Science to Understand Love and to Sort Out the Facts from the Fallacies. But today, he's going to tell us about the new phrenology, FRI. So, please welcome Dr. Fred Nour.
Thank you. So is phrenology coming back in a new disguise? Is functional MRI the new tool used for phrenology? Let's look at the best. Phrenology comes from phren, meaning mind, logos, meaning knowledge or science. Conceived 1798 by an Austrian neurologist, actually called Dr. Gard. And he has some concepts behind that. First one is the brain is similar to muscles. So if you use the brain, it gets bigger. If you don't use it, it shrinks. And that the brain is composed of multiple different areas, each one for one specific function, which you call faculty. Like the muscles, each muscle has one specific function. That if we use this mental faculty, then the area will get bigger, and the general of the brain will push the skull up and it will bulge out. And if we don't use it, it will shrink and the bone will sink in. And all we have to do is measure this surface, find a tool to measure this thing to justify the science. So if the gentleman over there had the carriage area lifted by 2 millimeters, that is scientific evidence that he is brave. And this unfortunate guy over there, the carriage area is depressed by 2 millimeters. That is scientific evidence that he is a coward. And all we need is a measuring tool, and that was the tool at the time. Sadly, it got out of popularity now. As a result of that, the brain got divided to multiple little areas, each one for one specific purpose, function, personality. It's all there. And do you want to make it like a science? Yes, we have peer-reviewed journals, so our publication adhere to the highest standards. Not only that, we have all over the world phrenology institutions to teach the practitioners about the latest and the most advanced way to practice that sophisticated science. And to come to the society as an example from one of the papers, this lady had this dent at the back of the skull, which tell you she is going to be a bad mother, and the bottom tell you, don't marry a woman who has that dent. And many other harms, many of them persist until today. Probably all of you still believe that music in the right half of the brain, pseudoscience. It took a century for it to go away and many people to find it. Now, in modern time, there's a new tool. So we go the same plans, and that is the functional MRI. To the same history, invented in 1990 by a physicist at the phone company. And he has some concepts. He said that the brain is composed of multiple systems, which he called network. So network one at the bottom is say network for dopamine, network two is the network for say serotonin. Now each network is composed of multiple cell groups. A1 is a group of cells, B1 is a group of cells, and so on. And they are connected by axons, electric wires, the light blue wires connecting them. And they work sequentially, meaning A1 sent to B1, B1 to C1, you cannot go backwards. And that each network is totally independent from the other one. Whatever happened in network 1 has nothing to do with network 2. And each cell member has to use energy in order to send the signal from A1 to B1, which causes B1 to wake up, use energy to send it to C1. They call that sudden increase in activation, turning the furnace, cell activation. And they also say that the rest, the network at rest, do nothing. Just sit down there doing nothing. And that's called the default mode of the network. You are asleep all the time, unless something happens to wake you up. And then when there's a demand for mental activity, you activate the cells. You turn the furnace on to send the signal. Concept number three, is that the cells in the brain do not use oxygen. So to get oxygen, you have to suck it from the tissues nearby. You convert oxygen hemoglobin to deoxygen hemoglobin. Oxygen is too negative. You change the magnetic properties. It moves in a magnetic field in a different way. We can graph it and put some pictures of that. And here's the typical function of MRI. Gray, black, and white is a traditional T2-weighted MRI picture that we use every day. But the function of MRI is the red, blue, and yellow dots that are generated by a computer based on statistics projected on top of that, and that's how we can tell what's happening in your brain. Let's look at the problems. Problem number one, that each network is independent. I can tell you as a neurologist, this is not true. Parkinson's disease is caused by dopamine deficiency. What if the patient cannot take dopamine? Is he doomed? No. I give medication that handles a different network. I block acetylcholine. Get exactly the same effect. How could it be if they're independent? What about depression? Is it serotonin? I can increase serotonin to get better. Again, no big deal. I increase norepinephrine. Same effect. Doesn't work? Never mind. I'll increase dopamine, norepinephrine. Melatonin, if that doesn't work, even if I can go to a totally different network, the NMDA, if I block it, instead of stimulating, the person gets better. Multiple networks, all of them lead to the same results, which means all the networks are continuously interacting with each other. Second claim is that the cell groups work sequentially because of the connection to the axon. You have the electricity, send it to send it to the axon to the next one that will wake up and do that. If you look at child at age 8, the connection between the cell groups is not myelinated, meaning it cannot conduct electricity at all. But if you do a functional MRI on a child and an adult, you get exactly the same pictures. If you look functionally how a child thinks about emotions, love, exactly the same as adults. Then why do you say that we have to connect them together to get that? Cell groups did not connect to each other to function. Problem number three, the default mode, that we're normally asleep unless something happens to wake us up. Evidence suggested that the brain consumes more energy at rest than during mental activity, opposite to what they say. Other studies with different technology found that we basically use the same energy all the time, whether we do mental activity or not. Interesting. And if you apply goggles to somebody awake and cast some lights, you have to think about it. You generate a functional MRI picture. If you put them under anesthesia, they're not thinking, they're doing anything, the signal should disappear. But no, it gets significantly bigger. How could that be if the signal is based on thinking? And think about it. If you work only when you get a bill and you don't have a bill, you sit down and relax. Would you ever need to have savings? What for? When I get a bill, I will work for you. Why is it that every brain cell, or most of them, have neurotransmitter storage for future use? You shouldn't have that if the theory was true. If you look at the time relationship between the cognitive ability or cognitive functioning and the activation, is not time locked. It happens at different times. And if you look at location, where in the brain it happened, you find that it happened at different location at different key. And I don't know what happened here.
Tell me, I'll get that.
When you do different studies, you find that it is not in the same location. Everybody find it in a different way. That's where I am now. Okay, then they tell you that the whole signal, the signal you see in function MRI, comes from taking from cognitive ability, cognitive activity. But the whole signal supposedly suggests that there's decrease in oxygen consumption. But what if I do the same cognitive function but change my breathing pattern? Well, the signal dramatically changes in function in my eye. Is it coming from my thinking or from my breathing? What we know as neurologists, certain locations are more susceptible to a drop in oxygen supply because they consume more. Could the activation be just picking up the area that normally needs more oxygen? We use in function MRI subtraction. We get an image addressed, an image in activity, and subtract the two. Many prove that this is literally impossible. The variation is at a maximum of 4% in a very high noise to signal ratio. Impossible to hear a whisper in very wide noise when the difference is very minor. And they put the oxygen consumption continuously while people at rest, continuously going up and down, not a flat line as they complain. The bottom line is the whole signal is not because of neurocognitive activity, it is some neurophysiological process that pick up. A lot of pseudoscience, I pick up just a few things. They tell you, I've seen the picture of the love center of the brain. This is the spot where love starts, called VTA. But if you damage the area, you feel the same love exactly. If you stimulate the area, you feel the same love exactly, no change. And a love Bill Clinton, based on the study, has personality based on estrogen, and Hillary based on testosterone. You know what happened. Now the system is falling. Started discovered in 1990, everybody studying emotions, personality, cognition, music. Just 2 years later, a neurologist in London realized the finding could be simply by coincidence. 2009, MIT used to look at the statistics and methods used and concluded there's possibly high correlation. And they found that more than 50% of the studies are designed in a method that guaranteed to show exaggerated correlation. And 2009, Dr. Bennett decided to duplicate study done on people looking at pictures of happy faces and angry faces, but he used a salmon. And he found the same changes in the brain of the salmon, even better. The salmon was there. 10 years ago, and I'll find it for you. Scientists at Stanford decided to do a database, so whatever you do submitted will have other people look at it. Out of 40,000 studies, only 18,500 submitted, the rest never did. 2006, last year, National Academy of Science published the largest study ever about function MRI by Swedish and British group and found false positive results of 73%, correct results 27%. Think about flipping a coin. You get it right 50%. A lot better than function MRI, cheaper and faster too. Science Journal agreed with the same thing. Nature decided if you want to publish function MRI study, you give us your data. You don't tell us what you find, you want to see it and give it to other people. And this year, NIH changed the criteria for making a study. And suddenly, the only people objected are those of behavioral scientists. And the exact writing, several neurocognitive scientific societies flooded the NIH, objecting about using this terrible so-called scientific method. In conclusion, phrenology is coming back to define different locations in the brain, each one for one specific function, and we updated the tool to something fancy called function MRI. Thank you.